It is part of the dignity of human beings that we are accountable. We cannot have a responsible society without laws. You cannot have laws without judgment. You cannot have judgment without punishment. And it's part of the dignity of being human that we are ultimately accountable to God.
Take a look around, it seems like we were all the same. We've got headphones screaming in our ears, and we're all scared of climate change. So I'm a sheep and I have gone astray. And what I really want is you. Caught up in a blaze. Could I be thankful even then that you gave and you took away? Love cost you more than I could ever know. But it's the only thing that's true, true.
In Paul's beloved book, Romans, he makes some tough, unashamed statements about salvation, God's sovereignty, judgment, and God's righteousness. Paul wrote the letter to the Romans as a foundation for their faith. Righteousness is the moral character of God. So how's your character? Today's message is called The Judgment of God.
If you got your Bible then, let me read to you from Romans chapter 2. I'm actually going to speak from Romans chapter 2 and 3. I'm going to read only a section of chapter 2 initially, though we'll be looking into chapter 3 as well. And this is quite a large section of scripture. As I have prepared this, I have begun to think I should have divided this up into a number of sections to understand it fully. But the overall theme that we're going to look at today is the judgment of God. This is what Paul takes time to write about in the detail that he does write about it here in these chapters. Let me read them from chapter 2 and verse 1. And you remember from last time in chapter 1, he is writing about the wrath of God, which is being revealed from heaven, he has said. Now he says, "You therefore have no excuse, you who pass judgment on someone else. For at whatever point you judge the other, you are condemning yourself, because you who pass judgment do the same things." Now we know that God's judgment against those who do such things is based on truth. So when you, a mere man, pass judgment on them and yet do the same things, do you think you will escape God's judgment? Or do you show contempt for the riches of his kindness, tolerance and patience, not realizing that God's kindness leads you towards repentance? But because of your stubbornness and your unrepentant heart, you are storing up wrath against yourself for the day of God's wrath, when his righteous judgment will be revealed. God will give to each person according to what he has done. To those who by persistence in doing good seek glory, honor, and immortality, he will give eternal life. But for those who are self-seeking and who reject the truth and follow evil, there will be wrath and anger. There will be trouble and distress for every human being who does evil. First for the Jew, then for the Gentile. But glory, honor, and peace for everyone who does good, first for the Jew, then for the Gentile. For God does not show favoritism. Well, keep your Bible open there. There's a lot there we need to talk about. I began last time by saying that when you go to visit a physician, their first and most important task is to make an accurate diagnosis of your presenting symptoms. If the diagnosis they make is wrong, then the remedy is going to be wrong. And Paul began a diagnosis in chapter 1, verse 18, which follows through until chapter 3 and verse 20. It's a diagnosis of the human condition. And it's a diagnosis that cannot be treated superficially or casually. For without a proper understanding of what is wrong, we will not get a proper understanding of the remedy. So far, we've looked at two essential ingredients that enable us to understand the gospel. The first was the righteousness of God in chapter 1, verse 17, when Paul wrote, "For in the gospel, a righteousness from God is revealed, a righteousness that is by faith from first to last." And we talked about that several weeks ago. And then secondly, we talked about the wrath of God in verse 18 of chapter 1, the wrath of God is being revealed from heaven against all the godlessness and wickedness of men who suppress the truth by their wickedness. I want to talk now from chapter 2 and chapter 3 about the judgment of God, because God giving over is only part one of the wrath of God. There is a part two. And in chapter 2, Paul writes about the day of God's wrath in verse 5. He says, "You're storing up wrath against yourself for the day of God's wrath when his righteous judgment will be revealed. It is true, God expresses his wrath in the present tense by giving us over here and now to the sins that we have embraced. But that is not the end of the matter. Like a runaway train that gains momentum as it rolls down the hill, it will eventually derail and destroy. And in chapter 2 and verse 16, Paul says, this will take place on the day when God will judge men's secrets through Jesus Christ. On that day, everything is going to be exposed and brought into the open. There'll come a day of judgment and a day of God's wrath. Now, this is not something to be either blasé about on the one hand, or cynical about, or, well, this is just a piece of doctrine. It isn't. It's about your life. And it's about my life. It's not a question of fitting this neatly into a little doctrinal box and saying, well, okay, this is that, this is that. It's something I personally, in my own life, you personally, in your life, have to face. Judgment is both necessary and logical. Human society cannot function without accountability for our behavior. Nations have to make laws, and they have to establish law courts by which violators of those laws can be legitimately and properly judged. We know that. We live in such a society. We cannot live in a nation where a pronouncement is made, we would prefer that you do not drive more than 110 kilometers an hour on the freeway. We would prefer you don't. Would you kindly think about this out of consideration of other people? But there's absolutely no recourse if you don't. We cannot live in a society that says, this is one of our values. This is our ideal that we do not steal from one another, but we have no recourse in the event of someone stealing. We cannot live in a society that offers us guidelines and says, one of the guidelines we would suggest is that you don't murder anybody. That's not good. We prefer you wouldn't do that, please. But we have no recourse in the event that that takes place. It is part of the dignity of human beings that we are accountable. We cannot have a responsible society without laws. You cannot have laws without judgment. You cannot have judgment without punishment. And it's part of the dignity of being human that we are ultimately accountable to God. God actually cares about how we live. That gives us incredible dignity. We're not nobodies. We're not incidental. And every one of us is accountable to God on that day. Now, I want you to notice something subtle, but very important in how Paul addresses sin, first in chapter 1, then in chapter 2. In chapter 1, he speaks in the third person about people's sins. That is, in verse 18, for instance, he speaks of the wickedness of men who suppress the truth by their wickedness. Verse 21, although they knew God, they neither glorified him as God nor gave thanks to him. Verse 22, they claimed to be wise, they became fools. Verse 24, God gave them over in the sinful desires of their hearts. This is just an example, because 30 times in 15 verses in chapter 1, he speaks about they, them, their, those. The they, the them are other people. They, whoever they are. Them, whoever them is. But now in chapter 2, Paul changes to the second person. And in verse 1, he says, you, not them now, You, therefore, have no excuse. You who pass judgment on someone else. For at whatever point you judge the other, you are condemning yourself because you who pass judgment do the same things. And I read that one verse as a sample because 42 times in the next 29 verses, he talks about you, your, and yours. This is about you. Now, I imagine at the end of chapter one, as people had this letter read to them in the church in Rome, there was some agreement from the Christians in Rome about Paul's analysis of their society. Rome was a very hedonistic society. And I imagine when they heard things like they did not glorify God, they did not give thanks to him, their thinking became foolish, their foolish hearts were darkened, they claimed to be wise but became fools, they exchanged the truth of God for a lie, they reaped the results of their perversions, they had become filled with every kind of wickedness, evil, greed, depravity, they are senseless, faithless, heartless, and ruthless, so God gave them over. I've just read 10 of the 30 occasions Paul speaks about they and them. And I imagine as this is read, there are people listening saying to themselves, amen. Paul has really understood the Roman hedonism and culture and depravity. They could see it all around them, of course. You know, there's little that unites people in their enthusiasm more than cataloging and condemning other people's sins. Little unites us like that. Nothing feeds the fire of our own egos like the exposure of other people's failures. It's relatively easy to get a crowd together to protest about other people's failures and sins. And Paul has opened up this possibility by saying it's about them, them, them. But then he turns the tables from the ambiguous them to the unambiguous and very personal you. That is our subject today. You, me, you, inside this building. You watching on television. Maybe in the privacy of your own home. You listening on the radio. We're going to put the blinkers on now, not look out there, because Paul has done that and everybody agrees with what's out there. We're now going to focus in on here, you, me. I'm going to point out three things that Paul speaks about here. First of all, God's judgment is individual. It's not blanket judgment. It is individually applied and given. Verse 1 again. You, therefore, have no excuse, you who pass judgment on someone else. Whatever point you judge the other, you are condemning yourself because you who pass judgment do the same things. Now, this may seem a rather presumptuous thing to say. Whatever point you judge the other, you are condemning yourself. Paul, do you really mean that? The answer is yes, he does. As did Jesus when he said, why do you look at the speck of sawdust in your brother's eye when there's a plank in your own eye? Why do you make the assumption there's a plank in your own eye? Because the evidence that you make a fuss of the speck in your brother's eye is you have something in your own eye. Because judging others is symptomatic of a cover-up going on within ourselves. Now, I'm not going to talk about that much this morning because there's a lot in this verse to talk about. But he makes that assumption. And in turning from talking about the third person then, he now talks about the second person, you, that you in passing judgment are all very well looking at other people and wagging your heads and saying, yes, they are doing bad things. But what about you? Says Paul. What about husbands who bully their wives with the Bible? Who will take hold of some verse and say to their wife, here it is, wives, submit to your husband, and conveniently remove it from the overarching context of that statement, which says immediately before, submit to one another out of reverence for Christ. And then it says, wives, doesn't use the word submit in the next verse, wives to husbands, and then husbands and how they are to wives, and explains how the husbands are to submit to their wives. And he says that they are to love their wives as Christ loved the church. Husbands, that's the verse we need to know about. And gave himself up for her. That's the kind of love our wives need from us. What do you give up for her? What do we give up? Or is it what we demand of her? To make her holy. The word holy doesn't sound like whole by mistake. Holy is to be whole. Cleansing her by the washing with water through the word. I'm reading what Paul said in that context. To present her without stain or wrinkle or any other blemish, but holy and blameless. You know, we men, we husbands, we're to give ourselves up for our wives, not dominate them, give ourselves up. Live sacrificially for their well-being. We are to commit to make her holy, not subservient. We're to work to remove stains and wrinkles and blemish, whether they're emotionally or psychologically or spiritually inflicted, and whether it's from way back in the past or whether it's from the present, that doesn't matter. We work to remove the blemish, not exploit it. Sadly, there are Christian husbands who add blemish to their wives. They don't remove it. Or another verse, which is often used to bully, the wife's body does not belong to her alone, but also to her husband. Nice one, huh? To demand your rights from her. Let's not get upset if that goes on right under our noses in some of our homes. See, this is what Paul does. They. Nothing contributes to a sense of smugness more than they do this and they do that and they deserve that. Then Paul comes right in. You are in the same situation. You. Verse 2 says, now we know, he says, that God's judgment against those who do such things is based on truth. Ours is based on prejudice, a prejudice against anybody else but ourselves. God's judgment is based on truth. Verse 11, God does not show favoritism. Well, we do, of course. We show favoritism to ourselves. We can excuse and justify ourselves, and we do. We are extremely self-defensive about ourselves. But Paul writes this in the context that whatever's going on out there, it is you. That is, judgment is going to expose and scrutinize and talk to you about. So God's judgment is individual first of all. Second thing I want to point out from here, God's judgment is internal. Verse 16, he says, God will judge men's secrets through Jesus Christ. That's the key to this second section of chapter 2. He will not be taken in by bluff. He will not be taken in by externals. It's our secrets that become exposed and become open. It takes courage to do that. I know that. It takes courage to go inside and bring those secrets out into the open. It takes courage. It can be painful. My wife and I are committed to no secrets between us. That's painful sometimes. It takes courage to get hold of your secrets and yank them out of the darkness where they've been hidden. But they're going to be brought out of the darkness. Because you see, God is not concerned with the externals. He's concerned with the secrets, because that's where everything derives from. Whatever's locked away in the secret part of your heart is going to make its way out. You may try to keep it locked up, but in due course, it will make its way out. That's why, you know, Jesus said in John 12, verse 47, he said, as for the person who hears my word but does not keep them, I do not judge him, for I did not come to judge the world, but to save it. I'm not looking at the outward form. I mean, we are very quick and easy to judge. Jesus said, I don't do that, so we have no right to do so. But rather, he is concerned with what goes on inside. So you remember when he preached the Sermon on the Mount? He said in Matthew 5, verse 21, you've heard that it was said to the people long ago, do not murder. Anyone who murders will be subject to judgment. And I'm sure the crowd listened. Yes, that's a good law. Murder is not good, and we don't murder. But, said Jesus, I say unto you, if anyone is angry with his brother, even though he never has the courage to put a knife into his back or put a bullet into his head, he is already guilty of murder. You've heard it said, you must not commit adultery, said Jesus. The apostle said, yes, we've heard that one. I sent you, said Jesus, if you look at a woman and you lust after her, even though you do not know her name, even though you don't know where she lives, you'd never have the courage to go knock on her door. You are already guilty of adultery. What's he saying? He's saying, I'm not really interested in the externals. We can all build a nice defensive external. That's not the real you. The real you is what goes on inside you. And that is what is to be exposed. You know, we can have our hidden agendas. We can have our secret intentions. We can have our false motives. And we can go about things with an external that looks fine. But it's all going to be exposed. And God is not the slightest bit interest in how piously we sit here on a Sunday morning and with butter would melt in our mouths if that isn't the way we behave when we go home. See, Paul's diagnosis, remember this is a diagnosis we're still looking at, moves from the world out there in chapter 1, which everybody's comfortable about and everybody agrees with and everybody can see. It moves to you, which is a lot less comfortable. The people of God he is writing to in here, I'm talking to you about you, he says. That is uncomfortable. And then he says, but not just you as everybody else sees you, but right into your heart. That is where the scrutiny of God takes place. God will judge men's secrets through Jesus Christ. We're going to see when we get to remedy, this is still a diagnosis, that the gospel of Jesus Christ gives us reason and courage and resources to go deep into the inner part of our beings. Because that's where the work has to be done. And if we're just dealing with externals, well, I prayed the prayer, and so I prayed the prayer, I'll go to heaven one day when I die. All we're doing then is turning the cross into a doormat to wipe our dirty feet on so we can get in with clean feet. That isn't the gospel at all. It's something much richer, much deeper, much fuller than that. And the third thing we'll talk about, it is here in these verses, God's judgment is individual, God's judgment is internal, but God's judgment is impartial. See, in the second half of chapter 2, he addresses himself to those who call themselves Jews, as he puts it in verse 17. He says, if you call yourself a Jew, if you rely on the law and brag about your relationship with God, he moves his focus now to those who call themselves Jews. And there were some Jews amongst the congregation in Rome, the Christian congregation there, as also there were, of course, Gentiles. But he moves the focus to the Jews because the Jewish people share a unique dilemma with Christian people. And it's this, that because we are the people of God, and because there is a security in being the people of God, and there are certainties attached to being the people of God, we put ourselves above others and adopt an elitist position, and also an entitled position. We have this sense of entitlement. I am okay with God now, therefore, my sin is not so important. So he says in these following verses, verse 17, you call yourself a Jew and brag about your relationship to God. Verse 18, you know his will and approve of what is superior because you are instructed by the law. Verse 19, you are convinced, you are a guide to the blind and a light for those who are in the dark. Verse 20, you are an instructor of the foolish, a teacher of infants, because you have in the law the embodiment of knowledge and truth. Now, when Paul writes this, my sense in reading it and rereading it is that he is writing this with a sense of sarcasm. He is saying, you call yourself something, you brag about something else, you know this, you approve that, you're a guide to these over here, you're an instructor to those over there, you have the embodiment of knowledge and truth. In other words, you have nothing left to learn. Wow. You really think yourself to be in a position that entitles you and allows you to develop a soft conscience and soft behavior when it comes to sin. Because then in verse 21, he says, you then who teach others, do you not teach yourself? You who preach against stealing, do you not steal? You who say that people should not commit adultery, do you commit adultery? You who abhor idols, do you rob temples? You who brag about the law, do you dishonor God by breaking the law? As it is written, God's name is blasphemed among the Gentiles because of you. Do you know something? The sins of Christians are far more significant than the sins of the world at large. For several reasons. One, because we have resources in the Lord Jesus Christ for a different quality of living. It doesn't involve perfection, but it involves a different quality of living where the character of Jesus Christ is reproduced in us and expressed through us. But more than that, it's when you sin, it is God who gets blasphemed, is what he says. God's name is blasphemed among the Gentiles because of you. See, the world is not naive. The world says, really? That's Christian, really? And you think I'd be interested in your God? Think of what that has done to blaspheme the name of God in the minds of people who say, these are the people who teach righteousness? Don't kid me. Look at how they behave. You'd have to talk to many people to get that kind of feedback. I've got it a number of times. Sit in the plane, start talking to somebody. What do you do? And then what do I do? And I tell them what I do. And so, oh, really? Oh, are you one of these people that tells people if they give you all their money that you'll give them, God will give them back a lot? Are you one of those thieves? You wouldn't believe how the name of God is blasphemed because of the atrocious sinfulness of Christian leaders. Paul says it there. Now, this is getting a little bit uncomfortable, isn't it? And so somebody jumps up in chapter 3 and verse 1 and says, what advantage then is there being a Jew? What value is there in circumcision? Now, Paul raises this question because he knows fine well the people he's talking to are starting to get uncomfortable. And so he asks the question, what advantage is there in being a Jew? In other words, if I'm a Jew, aren't I already within the covenant relationship with God? I can't lose that. So does it really matter because I am in that relationship with God? I thought that if I'm a Christian, I'm already right with God. I already have a security in my relationship with Him. I can't lose that. So it doesn't really matter as much, does it? That's behind this question in Paul's argument here. He says, is there any advantage in being a Jew? Of course there is. He says, there's much in every way in verse 2. And he gives some reasons. First of all, he says, they've been entrusted with the very words of God. Which means this. Because you've been entrusted with the very words of God, you have less excuse. You have less of an alibi if you try to produce one for your sin. Because to whom much is given, much is required, says Scripture. He who knows what to do and does it not, for him it is sin, says Scripture. Every new thing you know creates the potential for more sin because now you know something you didn't know before and you can commit sin. When I led the Bible school at Cape Moray in England, I used to say to the students, every time you learn something new, you create a greater capacity for sin. Because that greater capacity is in your disobedience to what you know. We used to have 5 classes a day. Everybody did the same course. And I say, supposing 4 of these classes don't teach you anything, but just 1 does in the day, that's 5 things a week, 5 days. You're here for about 30 weeks. 5 30s is 150. I said, it's extremely dangerous coming into this Bible school because in the next 30 weeks, you will increase your capacity for sin by about 150 times if you only learn one thing one day and 4 of the classes are boring. You don't learn anything. Every time you come into this building, I hope you learn something. But in so doing, you increase your capacity for sin. Is there any advantage in being a Jew? They say, he says, well, of course there is. First is, you know more than anybody else. Any advantage in being a Christian when it comes to my sin? Yeah, there's much more advantage in being a Christian. You know more, which means you can live in the good of what you know, or you have a greater capacity to disobey. And then there's a couple of remarkable excuses that allow Christians to sin. Here in verse 5 of chapter 3, if our unrighteousness brings out God's righteousness more clearly, what should we say? That God is unjust and bringing his wrath on us? You know, okay, so I behave badly. I commit sin. I engage in unrighteousness. Doesn't that bring out God's righteousness more clearly? It shows him off in his grace and goodness by the fact he forgives and he forgives and he forgives. And so if my unrighteousness shows off God's righteousness, why in the world does God treat me with wrath? That's the argument. Paul doesn't answer these things because they're so, he treats them with contempt actually, but he raises them. And I'm a Christian now. I can show God's wonder by the fact he has to forgive me for a lot. I'll give him some really big ones. You know, that's the argument. This is the wrong deductions that come from the wonderful doctrine of eternal security. Because there is a judgment day for believers. There is a loss for believers. We haven't time to go into the other scriptures. But our works will be judged, and some will be like wood, hay, and stubble, which all burn up in the fire, some like gold, silver, precious stones, which are refined by the fire. But there's going to be a judgment of them. And then in verse 7, Paul says, someone might argue, if my falsehood enhances God's truthfulness and so increases his glory, why am I still being condemned as a sinner? Why not say, as we're being slanderously reported as saying, and as some claim that we say, let us do evil, the good may result. That's a slight variation of the same argument. My falsehood brings out God's truthfulness. My sin brings out his glory. And Paul was being accused of this. But he refutes it absolutely here, that it's not a question that my sin shows the contrast of God's glory. How does God show his glory? How does God show his truthfulness? He shows it in us. And so he shows it. So you can't say, well, my sin will show up his glory. No, your sin will disguise his glory. Because Christ in you is your hope of glory. That's where the glory of God is seen, Christ living within us. We are being transformed from one degree of glory into another, into his likeness. It is in us he shows his glory. So you can't say, well, you can sin just to show in contrast his glory. No, you are the expression of his glory. That does not mean perfection. But God works in a man's life, in a man's heart, in a woman's heart, in a young person's heart, in such a way that in them you begin to see and sense something of the presence of God himself. But if you're not living in that relationship and you are instead saying, well, I'm okay on the one hand, I'm on my way to heaven, and I've got security about that, but I can play around with the other and I can ill-treat my wife and my family. And you see, we're kidding ourselves. We're deluded. Perfect love casts out fear. That's the antidote when a wife is fearful of her husband or a husband is fearful of his wife. That's the antidote. Perfect love. And you don't get that overnight, but you got to work on that. And a measure will be the measure to which there is no fear because it's driven out. And when the glory of God is not seen in us, back to Paul's statement, God's name is blasphemed among the Gentiles because of us. And so when the world looks at the Christian church, they see the Lord Jesus Christ exhibited in people, people they work with, people they live next door to, people in their families, people who are in-laws, where Jesus Christ lives in the person's life and they see the glory of God. They won't like it and they won't recognize what it is. But if they don't see that, they'll simply blaspheme him and they'll see in you the crookedness of your own selfishness. That's what Paul is saying to these believers, these Jews and these believers, believing Jews in Rome. And so he concludes, verse 9, what should we conclude then? Are we any better? And he says, not at all. I've already made the charge that Jews and Gentiles alike are all under sin. That's in verse 9. There is no one righteous, not even one in verse 10. There is no one who understands. No one seeks God. Verse 11, verse 12, all have turned away. There's no one who does good, not even one, for all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God in verse 23. And he gives this comprehensive set of statements that leave us standing accused, exposed, and guilty. Now, I'm going to finish at this point. Let me remind you, this is the diagnosis of the disease. And before a physician can begin to apply the remedy, we've got to understand the diagnosis. And having made this diagnosis, a diagnosis we must take seriously, we must think about me, not where does this fit into doctrine, but what does this say about me and where is it true about me and what needs to happen in me? That's the diagnosis. But I finish with this, which we'll pick up next week. Having made the diagnosis, he says in chapter 3, verse 21, but now a righteousness from God apart from law has been made known, to which the law and the prophets testify. This righteousness from God comes through faith in Jesus Christ to all who believe. This is now the physician, having made the diagnosis, and of course the patient must agree with the diagnosis to get the remedy. He must agree, yes, this is where I am. He then says, now let's look at the remedy. And he takes a number of chapters to talk about the remedy. But what he begins to say here in chapter 3, verse 21, and goes through the end of chapter 3, is, I suggest you, the very heart of the Bible and the very heart of the Christian message. And we can hear it, understand it, repeat it. We won't know it until we also know the diagnosis and we're honest about the diagnosis. Because the remedy is not a doctrine you stick on a shelf. It's a medicine that is applied to the need. We're going to pray together. And I want to suggest we take just a few moments of quiet. Some of you may feel a long way from dealing with what God has exposed in your heart this morning. As I have been speaking, your mind has gone in all kinds of directions. Some of you thinking about your marriage. Some of you thinking about your manner of work in the workplace, your integrity in your income tax forms. I don't know how God has spoken to you. Would you speak to him? Lord, we're so grateful this morning that this verse sits here in Romans 2. Do not show contempt for the riches of his kindness, tolerance, and patience, not realizing that God's kindness leads you towards repentance. We pray, Lord Jesus, there will be repentance in the hearts of those of us who need to repent. We know it's more than just being forgiven for the past, but finding our way out of the sinking sands that we feel we're in, the habitual behavior we don't know how to deal with, the habits, even addictions, we find our hearts and minds locked into. Lord, thank you, there is a way. There is a way back. But we recognize it begins with repentance. At the cross of Jesus, confessing, being honest, being open about the secrets of our hearts, thanking you for your forgiveness, but thanking you that more than that, you would lead us on to a life of godliness and holiness. Pray, Lord Jesus, that there'll be lives here this morning that will change as a result of your word. Marriages, it'll be different. Family life, it'll be a joy to be part of. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen.
Do you know someone who would benefit from this message? Share it through our website, livingtruth.ca. And while you're online, join the discussion about this week's message and follow the links to our Facebook page and YouTube channel. Tune in next week for another message from Charles Price, The Cross of Christ. The book of Romans reveals the answers to important questions and provides information on many topics such as salvation, the sovereignty of God, judgment, spiritual growth, and the righteousness of God. In Paul's beloved letter, he makes some tough, unashamed statements about God's righteousness. Paul wrote the letter to the Romans as a concrete theological foundation for their faith. This series by Charles Price is available on CD and DVD. Learn at home, give to a friend, or plan a group Bible study. To order this series, write to the address on your screen or call +1 416-222-3341, extension 113. To order online, visit livingtruth.ca. Righteousness is the moral character of God. So how's your character?
Judgment, so slow to see the good inside. So take me, Lord, and teach me mercy, they're all your temples in the skies, and let me see your plan for me, despite calamity. Will as I run, as I run for the prize. Oh, let me see the world through your eyes. For once my eyes are true. Take my fear, take my life. Lord, take my life. And let me see your plan for me. My place is by calamity.